So, welcome everyone to this first lesson in this class of Exploring Machine Intelligence. We are in the first week, looking at the introduction and motivation about this whole class. So, why would you be exploring machine intelligence? So, the main reason is that machine learning has become quite an influential part of our everyday life, and it also entered the current art scene. And so, the goal of this task, of this class, is to maybe teach you how to understand when you see an artwork created by machine learning, how to understand what is happening in the background, maybe to identify the model and then maybe get a better idea why the thing that you are seeing is somehow interesting and not traditional. And eventually, this class should also help you make your own machine learning art. So, kind of make use of your own backgrounds and then bring them into this new domain of editing data with machine learning. Okay, so there will be few rapid fire examples just to kind of get you excited about this whole domain. And the first one is by Anna Riddler, the Mosaic Virus from 2019, and this is something you probably have seen around in the CCI. It's her work using generative adversarial networks, which is an entire area that we will have a class dedicated to, so I will not even start explaining about them. But just briefly, there are models that can learn on a large data set of images, so something like this, and then they learn how these images look, behave, what are the shapes that are in these images, and they learn how to mimic these. And so you can then explore this model's sort of learned imagination and then see what the model has learned as these images. So you can use it to generate new images which are based on this original dataset. However, they are never the same or not the same. They're not always the same, right? There are some interesting samples sort of in between of these original images. And so the idea is really, or the question really is, if what you are creating here is something new because it's something that was not in the dataset, or if it's something just recycled from the dataset. And I would say that these can create new images, but sometimes the creation becomes glitchy and what you get is some sort of distortion made by the model. So I guess what's really interesting is when it becomes an interpolation between some samples which were there in the original dataset, but they are sort of uncanny, so they feel strange when you look at them. And that's what happens when the images that you're creating are something that looks like it is real, but there is some small detail which is somehow broken, and you can see that. And so further than that, I think Anna Riddler's work is quite interesting because she's always approaching datasets in a very personal manner, meaning that she has been collecting these samples of tulips on her own. So physically collecting the tulips and then making pictures of them, so building the dataset on her own, which is something, given the fact that these neural networks usually take around 30,000 samples or something to train, it's quite an involved process. But also that kind of enhances the amount of curation you have over the images that are created by these models. Okay, this is quite a nice example of deepfakes that I found recently, actually. This is a recent work by the Canny AI, and probably you have probably seen some deepfake videos and images before, which is where someone can use their own sort of face to transport the movement onto any other actor. The neural network that is behind this is usually trained on images of either people in general or of this actor or of this target kind of person, Obama in this case. Well, and so in this case, you can. This is some relatively new research which came out in this year, where they are able to do this very kind of accurately. Okay, so I love this one because it is a really creative use of this technology. I think deepfakes have been getting some coverage of being a relatively malicious technology that can be used to impersonate someone else and then try to kind of fake your own identity or create individuals that then can kind of steal an identity. However, this is a statement, kind of just selecting the sometimes trustful, sometimes slightly sketchy nationalist leaders from all over the world and having them sing on Imagine from John Lennon. This is great. I think this is also a good example where it's a combination of some deep learning technology behind this, so the model which is doing it, but also kind of the production quality of a team which is actually who knows what they are doing, and then cutting a video from this. I think it might be part of some campaign by this company to kind of bring customers to them. So they are selling something as well. This is an ad actually, but anyway, it is a creative use of this technology, and I mean, definitely it made my day when I saw this video. So yeah, deepfakes. So another category that I would like to, I mean, we are just going through some examples, some fast examples here. So another category that machine learning models allow us to kind of explore is to look at the data that we threw into those models and then kind of extract some sort of smaller dimensional vector, which then describes these images or these data that we gave it. So this is relatively incomprehensible, I bet, but this means that we can kind of encode all of these images into using these networks into some space, and then in that space look on the trajectories and then kind of try to search for what is near each other. So inside this space, what is next to each other is something which is considered sort of similar in terms of its visual information in the image. So using this, we can kind of traverse through imagery datasets outside of the usually used categories. So we can actually look at what is the imagined path between a very modernist Mondrian painting and then something classical, sort of like the Tower of Babel here. So there are a bunch of these demos as well online, and you can kind of just look at the different trajectories from different through their archive. And so actually it's kind of interesting to see this as a the potential use of this would be to explore art galleries with this, or explore some datasets of objects, basically for either for curation, that you are selecting something which kind of relates together, or actually doesn't really like belong together, but somehow is still, for the network at least, close to each other, which might create some kind of new and exciting connections between the images. But also just to kind of make sense of a, let's say, a really large dataset of images that you have no way of traversing yourself, looking at each one of these images one by one, you can use some techniques like this to just visualize all the data somewhere on a big board and then go through one to one and then like look at these paths in between. Okay, so kind of related to this, well, not necessarily related, but slightly similar to this is and was the work of Jenny Odell, who was a who is an artist who was collecting images from satellite imagery, so from basically Google Maps. She was going one by one, kind of on certain areas of maps, and then searching for these shapes inside the landscape, and then kind of making collections of them, right? So this is kind of obsession of by shapes, and so there is another work by Carnegie Mellon University where they did a project called Terra Pattern, which brings this as an idea to search through maps in terms of this similarity that we saw in this previous slides. So it kind of clusters together the images which are visually similar, and this means that no one had to actually tell the model hey, this is a roundabout of this size, but it will kind of know that it is visually similar and then cluster them together. So let's watch another bit of the video here. So here are some examples of the images that were found through this model and through this project, where basically it's just clustering together images that are similar. So something which we saw already, but also just finding the same shapes in the world. So we can kind of imagine that this is a new way of searching through data, where we don't have to sort of say, hey, I'm looking for this, and describe it kind of obnoxiously, have to describe what you are looking for, but kind of just show it one thing that you are searching for, and then it will kind of pop up with the things that are similar to it. Right, so yeah, that's enough of this. If we go back, so some more examples of Jenny Odell's work is this one, where she selected 206 circular farms, and so she just displayed them one by one next to each other as a sort of dataset visualization, but also kind of a compression of some particular type of shape that caught her attention. And so this really goes way back into the history of photography, for example, into the photographical work of Hilla and Bernd Bechers, who were shooting photographs on black and white analog camera, and they were kind of collecting, I mean, it was not called datasets then, but they were collecting images of kind of typographical description of some certain types of objects, where the shapes were kind of related together. And I think they started by shooting first the objects themselves, and maybe in the same kind of, from the same perspective, from the same viewpoint, and over time started making collages of these and kind of just started playing around with the shapes. And so what we see here is no longer these gas towers, but you look at the abstraction of those. So it's working with the abstracting of a shape from some real object. And so this work is somehow related to this, and then if it's done with machine learning, it's something that's done automatically from the datasets. Right. Right. So, I mean, these were just a few examples that are supposed to sort of excite you about the course, but let's kind of go into the more details into explaining what will expect us these 8 weeks. So exploring machine intelligence is a class where we will have 8 weeks of classes and then kind of 2 weeks of examination. We will go through the basics, meaning we will have to explain some basic concepts and then also start writing in Python. I don't know how much is everyone familiar with coding in Python, so there will be some basic small steps towards coding something more creative and large. We will definitely have to go through sort of history of the models as they came along. I mean, this looks like a very exhaustive list. However, they are kind of interesting models, and you can kind of learn what is interesting as a concept from these and then use it later in your own work. So we will learn about these models and also when and how to use them. So hopefully also bring all of these models that we are talking theoretically about at start actually into some Google Colab notebooks, and then have them at least at our disposal, and then learn how to actually fire up those models and then use them with our data. So kind of important as well is that we will learn how to misuse these models, so sort of the ways how we can hack them in a way, which means that maybe use them outside of the context when they were supposed to be used, and then use them in some slightly strange ways. So maybe exploring parts of the landscape that the model has learned where there were no data, so there are some interesting glitches happening there, or actually trying to break them in a way that stretch them at the moments where they no longer work, and what kind of trying to explore what that means for us if we are supposed to use these models in everyday life. We can try sort of chaining these models together and kind of see what what that does for the created works as well. And also finally, we will have some among these 8 lessons, 8 weeks, we will have some lessons by the amazing Rebecca Fiebring, who is a scholar here at CCI, and she's an expert in machine learning and interaction. So it's quite lucky to have her teach you about some of her work. I think it will be something about her Vaccinator stuff. Okay. So, what would be the goal? I guess besides all of these points, what could also be the goal is that you can sort of learn about new things in the class and also start working on something of your own. Maybe mix in some of your backgrounds, kind of background interests, and then stare whatever project we are working on into a direction which kind of combines these new concepts and some of your own creativity from before. And we could kind of make some larger projects at the end, and possibly even if it's good, sort of we can think of pushing these as projects into some online galleries and some workshops which are mainly interested in the work which is with the creative work which is at the edge of AI and machine learning and also arts. So for example, this includes the NeuRIPS machine learning for creativity and design workshop, which is a creative space where they select works from AI which touch on kind of art creation, or try to use machine learning models in some interesting ways. Okay. So, I guess at this moment you would like to know also who am I, this voice speaking to you from your machines, where you are watching this video. So I am Vítek Růžička, I am a researcher in machine learning, and I took several classes which were like originally still in the domain of computer sciences, but then slowly moving towards machine learning, and then uses in something as art and machine learning directly. So I was taking this class at Carnegie Mellon University by Eun Sukang and Barnabás Pocos, which was really the, I guess, eye-opening class for me to bring these domains together. Because I was always interested in machine learning with my computer sciences kind of education, but also with arts, because I was I am still very much interested in doing analog photography, which is basically as far as you can get from a digital realm, is going into a dark room and then using your own hands to develop some photographs. And so I kind of still do want to combine these worlds, and so this means kind of going from both sides and exploring what happens in the middle. And so this is who I am. The classes that I can kind of recommend, on one hand, if you are looking for some more contents or some more information for you to study from, and also actually maybe something that we can be inspired by, are these two classes, the art and machine learning done at Carnegie Mellon, where we can actually use some of the codes that they have been looking at and then use them in our classes as well. So maybe using some Google Colabs. And so the second class I could recommend is the Neural Aesthetic class, which is a class which has been taught at the New York University by Gene Kogan, who is a kind of great teacher about topics in machine learning and where they touch the aspects of art. And so the whole name Neural Aesthetics is kind of talking about the way that everything that we create with machine learning now, it has a certain feel and certain aesthetic to it. So it becomes something that is distinguishable from other forms of art. Okay, so maybe to illustrate my work a little bit, I am also working with GANs, trying to kind of find strange datasets to teach these GANs with, and then maybe have some sort of the concept of movement extracted from those images, and or maybe try to mimic some strange data and datasets that I got my hands on. And also, as I was mentioning, my interests in photography, I was also trying to mimic some sort of image redistribution of a dataset created on a film, so on a Super 8 camera. So all of this will be kind of explained more when we get to it, but I will bring these examples again. But just so you know a little bit of this. So I have been already talking about Rebecca Friebring. She's a reader here at Creative Computing Institute, and she will be taking some classes, or she will be teaching some classes with us, probably something with interactivity and machine learning, and maybe something, some projects with Akinator. Okay, and so that brings us to the today's lesson. As I was saying, we will go through some very basic concepts in this class. We will see some more examples of what I was showing you before, and some examples from art. And later we will go into some programming basics as well. We will be modeling data with a first model that is very easy to understand as well. Okay, this brings us to the concept of a model. So what is a model? What do we have here, and how does this work? So in all of those previous cases, we got to create something interesting with these. However, we still do have to start at some basic level. So we need to talk about what is a model. And a nice parallel is actually treating it as a black box, to which we have some inputs on the left and some outputs which go out of it on the right. And this parallel sort of works with the idea or with the imagination that you are using some software and you are just plugging in some boxes in the a pipeline, and you have some data flowing from the left, and then you want to do something with it. And so you don't really care about what's happening inside the model, but you have some expectations of what it will do with your data. And so we have some kind of, we are creating some sort of translation here. We are translating from the inputs into the outputs. And there is a period of time when we are sort of showing new inputs and new outputs to the model, and we are asking it to sort of train on those two, on these pairs of data. So this is called training, as we are sort of fixing some parameters inside the model so that they can successfully translate some input data into the outputs. And then later, we usually want to kind of mimic the same relation that we showed the model before, just with using some new data. So we will give it some new images and then ask it to classify or do something with the data that we trained it on. So repeat the task, trying to, we expect it to do similar sort of relation between the data to mimic that. Okay, so these models, they tend to have some parameters. So you can imagine that as like a, as this pictogram, as a changeable knob that you kind of have to turn in a way. So in a way that these inputs will correspond to the outputs. So when training it, you have a bunch of these wheels that you have to set in a way, in a certain way, so that the data flows in that way that it translates from this this type of data into this type of data. And so when we are training, we are usually changing these parameters. Actually, this is a better image of for this. We have a bunch of parameters inside the model, and we are changing just some of these in order that everything that flows in actually goes through these, let's say, pipes, and then gets at the end in a way that we want, right? And so, yeah, another concept is, we always were talking about the inputs and outputs. What that is usually some data. And this data can be basically anything, but usually it tends to be some numbers or some images, as in this case, or maybe encoded sounds and yeah, many other things as well. Usually we have paired data. So for some incoming input data, we have a output label. So this would have a label which someone had to make called cat, and this would have to have a label which someone had to make called cat car, And so we are training this model, so changing these parameters around so that the model learns that this image is a cat and this image is a car. How that happens, we will see that in later classes, probably next week. So let's just assume this is a black box which can do it when we select the correct parameters. And actually, what is a parameter and how to set it, we will see in today's practicum. So don't worry about that if you don't get it yet. Right, and so here is a problem, right? We trained the model on cats and cars, and then here comes the contender, which is something in the middle. And so this is an illustration, and yeah, we don't know what this would say. I guess it would say car or cat or be somewhere in the middle. And so this is an illustration that we have been using some training set, so some images that we know are some like from this one domain and then from this domain. And we trained it on that, but then we deploy this model into the real world, and then we see that actually it's failing in a bunch of cases because we have not included the diversity which is in the real world into our model. Or maybe the quality of the samples is much different because maybe the light conditions, because of the light conditions, or because of the diversity of data that it has been shown before. So this is something interesting to explore as well, because finding where these models break, these breakpoints, might be something to illustrate a point, maybe. Okay, and so how in the world does this relate to creativity? So we have been talking about these black boxes, input, outputs, some image data, classifications of cats and cars. How does this relate to creativity? Well, I guess I will show the next slide. It relates to something creative when the domain here becomes some images or sounds or videos. So you become able to actually generate some visual information from something that you fed it in into the model. And I mean, this then relates to all the other examples we have been showing in this class, so I will not kind of go deeper in all of them, but this is a moment where we can create something new with this. The question, if this is actually, if the model here is actually creative, is a valid question, and it's not answered by this diagram at all. We will read the paper which kind of talks about this a little bit. Okay. Right. So this is a example where this is an illustration of the concept from the previous slide, where we have a model called Pix2Pix, which is translating images from one domain into another domain, and it depends on what you train it on, but some people here trained it on cats. So it is a model which is capable of kind of filling in the blanks, let's say, of this image, and then it fills in the cat. Actually, it paints the cat from the shapes. The model is called Sketch2Cat, and it's one of the Pix2Pix models. Okay, and so this is the first model which has been trained on cats, and then sometimes someone uses it and then creates something different from it. I guess expands the domains. Tries something different than it was trained on. So this is a bread cat. Okay. Right, so we will now go through a bunch of examples. We will slowly get to the more creative one, the more the ones including generative models and then deep dreaming and some neural network hacking, but we first have to go through the basic tasks which have been used with machine learning. So the whole story started with classification. What is a classification? It's kind of assigning an image its own label. And so in this case we have just one item in the image, and we can create these almost like dictionaries of images to descriptions or labels, and then have a model which is trained on this. And so it is able to classify what is in the image. Right. What came after that was that we no longer want to identify just one image, one object inside the image, but also assign sort of bounding boxes. So find where the items are, what are the items, have multiple items in one of the images, and then also go even forward and then maybe have a pixel precise segmentations of where the images are. And I mean, this is cats, dogs and ducks, but let's say you imagine that there is some brain scan here and we are not identifying a dog versus cat, but we are identifying the healthy parts and the not so healthy parts as well. Right. So example of the first task I was talking about was the classification, and that is assigning some label to an image. And so this is a visualization that was used with the 2012 from a model called AlexNet from 2012, and this was a sort of breakthrough in deep learning, where there was a dataset called ImageNet, which just contained a bunch of these images, millions and millions of these images, and then they were labeled by people. And so the task there was to train any sort of model to be able to assign from image into this label. So in 2012, this was the first model which used the approach of deep neural networks. They used convolutional neural networks, which is something that we will get to later as well, but it really doesn't matter that much. So the then best performing model had error around 26%, and just by using this model they were able to push it into around 16%. And so, just by the way, human performance is around 5%, so this was a large jump in front, like in the good direction. And this was 2012, and today in 2020 there is a model which is performing around 2%, so it's achieving better than humans, you could say. Or it's or you could also ask if it's actually legit to ask humans to classify these images, because you look at this image, it could be a mite, but it could be also other things. So sometimes these images tend to be slightly less easy to identify, to label by one class, right? Do we care about humans in this image, or do we care about the scooter? I guess they cared about the scooter, but who decides that? So there are all these clever questions that you need to answer. And I guess this would account for the error that the humans are making. Okay, so this would be an example of the object detection, so assigning bounding boxes. And this is a very famous model called YOLO. Okay, so let's see the video. Okay, so this is a model which can assign labels to everything it sees in the image. And as you can see, it is capable of doing this at very fast rate. I mean, this is a demo on some movie. So they could have done this offline and then sort of assemble the frames later, which they probably did. But the truth is that this model, YOLO, is also capable of doing this in real time. And so we will touch that area later entirely, but to have something be fast enough to have real-time performance versus having a model which is very precise but relatively slow is world difference, especially when it comes to usability of this model in art context or in some performative context where we want to interact with the model in real time. Okay, so enough of this. Okay, so let's look at this example. It is the same model that we saw in the previous one, however focusing just on humans in this case, and also in a 4K video. So when compared with this, the resolution here is probably something around 600, at least when the model is looking at it, pixels, whereas here we have 4000 pixels by 1000 something. So the resolution and the amount of details that it can pick from these images is way higher. So it can actually detect even some of these humans in the background, which, I mean, not all, because sometimes maybe there is occlusion between the people, but this is kind of showing how these models can be scaled. Okay, another example of a task where we are sort of now leaving the area of these three canonical tasks of classification, object detection and image segmentation. There is a model called NeuralTalk. And it's capable of describing what is the model seeing. So this image that is on the screen, by a text description. And so this is something that has been generated for each frame. And as you can see here, it is running relatively choppy, but the case is that this is running in near real time. So it's generating these descriptions frame by frame in the real time. Okay, so let's move it a little bit. It recognizes some items but fails on other. I think there is a funny example here, right, where a group of people standing something on a sidewalk. And a man and a man holding a hot dog in a bun with a mustard and ketchup. And yeah, then it just goes off. So the task was to label some images with a human readable description. Okay? And right, so we now get to the area of generative models. Again, there is a plenty of them, and we will just show the latest, greatest ones, which one of them is also relatively famous, is the StyleGun, and it is most well known for the capability of generating human faces, but this is just because it was trained on a celeb A dataset of human faces. So this, what you can see here, is a interpolation through latent space, which is something like looking through all the possible images that are saved inside this model and then just traversing the landscape of this model. So we will get into the details of why is it interesting and how it is done later, but this just shows sort of the whole spectrum of images that have been saved, right? And so this example is by Memo Atken, and his exploration is sort of different from this one, which was mostly random, and he's using a different GAN model. So in this case, it's a model like the traveler is more playing with the associations between the images, and so it's trying to find some samples which are sort of breaking it and maybe going among some strange categories, and also actually discovering some very uncanny images and maybe some glitchy artifacts inside the model. Yeah, that was a nice part, I think. Okay. So these were GANs. How to interact with them, that's a whole area of research, and we will get back to it as well when we are talking about GANs more. Also, GANs are not necessarily only trained to do some sort of top task like this, to mimic images, but they can also be used to other things. So this is the task of super resolution. So the model is trained on a bunch of images, basically, and it will create lower scale resolution of these images and then train on this translation. So train to translate a lower scale images into higher scale resolution. So it is called super resolution. And so this has been used in the gaming community to kind of mod in older textures to add in the details that were not there and kind of to upscale all the games. And so some of them are really crazy because the amount of detail that is added is quite large. But there are some caveats there because we are always adding some details that was not there. So this is an example of using this model and using it again and again and again. And so what happens is that the detail that was there degrades and artifacts that are added there every iteration. So with every jump between frames, we are looking at kind of the next super and more super and more super resolution of the image, and you can see that if you overdo it, you are breaking it. And so it really questions if even just doing it once, if we are not bringing in some information that was not there. So Yeah, imagine your phone doing this, and then you discover that all of your images actually contain shapes of something that was not there in real life. That's not an augmentation we really want. Okay? So yeah, one of the other quite famous examples of AI and machine learning is the AI Dungeon game, and this is a an example of text generation using LSTM models. What is that? We will get into that later, definitely. But these are models that can be trained on language, on human natural language, on human speech, and they are able to predict, given a sentence, to predict the next most probable word. And so there is a network, or there is a model called GPT-2, which was a huge one, trained on really large amount of data from the internet. And what they did was to train this model, to fine-tune it on pieces of text from adventure games. And so what this becomes is an interactive fiction where you can write new things into it, and it will always respond with an answer. The answer is not always what you expect, but it's sort of able to play along with you. So it's sort of like, I guess it was related to a sort of playing with a drunken game master in Dungeons and Dragons. So there is a nice article about this by a gaming newspaper or news page, Rock Paper Shotgun, which, yeah, if you are interested, do give it a look. Okay, and so now we are slightly kind of exploring more the area of features of embeddings and a similarity, which is something that was shown in the first few examples that we were seeing in this class. And so what happens here is that using some sort of neural network, we encode all these images into this space by 2D grid, and we put together the ones that are similar image-wise. So on this space you can then look at the trajectories and find what is the interpolation from here all the way to here and see what's in the middle, but you can also kind of search for similarities. And how this is interesting and useful for archives or collections or for creative purposes. And I would relate it to something like the Barnes Foundation, which is a museum or a art gallery in Philadelphia, where each it's a private collection, and the artworks there are displayed in sort of not haphazard, but not really clear way why is something shown with something else. So they have left the usual style of clustering and segmentation or placing together items from the same era, but they are going sort of across and maybe actually working with some sort of similarity, or maybe actually some sort of collage of items to perhaps look at the contrast between the images that are shown together or look at the similarities. So this is not the same thing, but it's sort of living in the same area. These models on their own cannot do something like this, but when worked with, you can sort of use these latent landscapes to have some assemblies of images like this. Okay, so here is another kind of well-known area, which is called the Deep Dream. It's a work by Alexander Mordvintsev from 2015, now relatively old when it comes to machine learning artworks and what is being considered new in research. This is an approach to sort of edit the incoming image, the input image. And so, without still explaining what this is, we will get to that in the later classes, next week probably. We have some plugged-in model here, and there is some, let's call it feature, or some neural, some network, I mean some neuron here in the network, which is responsible to detect dogs, for example. And so we change and optimize this incoming image in a way that it maximizes what this neuron would consider as its input. So it's sort of changing the incoming image so that it becomes more dog-like, if you like. So this is a technique that was used first as a means of visualization, but then it came across that it actually can edit these images. And so if you do this with Paul Serrat's image, this is what happens. Basically, you are adding in features, details to the original image. And this is also quite a nice statement, because this is a pointillist piece of art, and this is kind of, again, bringing out the smallest particles, the points, and then changing them into something else. Right, maybe what is more known from this method, from deep dreaming, is something like this, which is a visualization or deep dreaming on Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas. Yeah. And so what you get is really uncanny images, and like, there is a lot of puppy slugs, basically, just dog-like shapes and slug-like shapes. And there are reasons behind this, why it's all dogs and slugs. And the reason is because in the original ImageNet, what this was trained on, there were a lot of dog breeds. So all of these models are kind of capable of creating dog-like images when used with Deep Dream. Okay. And so yeah, we are getting to the last category, which is kind of maybe misusing some of these neural networks. I mean, this is sort of already getting there, but this is a statement by Mario Klingermann, which is this one. I often chain together multiple GANs that have been trained for different purposes. Some models generate faces from biometric face markers. Others generate face markers from images. So one of them is a generative model, the another one is more like an analytical model. And so when you chain these two together, you are sort of doing a task and then undoing it, but you are also discovering what is being lost in that moment, in this transition. Others are trans enhancements, GANs that hallucinate new details and textures from incomplete information. So this might refer, might not as well, this might refer to inpainting, where if you erase some part of the image, there are methods how to fill in the blanks, sort of as you saw in the first examples as well with the cats. And so, especially work by Mario Klingermann, a lot of it is really pushing the boundaries of already existing neural networks. So that's why I'm calling it hacking, because they are misusing it, chaining it in surprising ways, and then trying to show what these models are capable of. Right, so it's not as easy to say that everything that a GAN creates is an art, not on its own. What an artist does with a GAN network is something that can be considered art, in my opinion at least. I think Mario Klingermann also coined the term neurographers, which means it's based on photography. Photographe means painting or drawing with photons, with light, which is used when you are shooting on a camera and you are recording the light that's coming in. This is neurography, which means painting with neural networks. So, if you will, this is an entire new area of art where we are using these models to create it. So it's a new tool, it's a new aesthetic that is created by these. Okay, so this brings us to the first pause. After the pause, we will get back into a more practical part of the lesson. So right now, all of this was mostly just looking at videos and cool examples and images, which all of these we will go through in the later weeks, but all of it was just very conceptual as well. So now we will get into a very basic, simple model, and we will show how to make that in a code. Okay, so welcome back after the pause. Now we will go into the more practical part of the lesson. So I know it's the first week, first class, so the practical aspects will be relatively easy. We will start coding a little bit, but it will be very student friendly. So we talked a little bit about the topic of models, that you have something in the middle and then you want to set that in a way that it mimics the data that you are feeding it in. And one of the simplest models that we can kind of show this on is the linear regression. And we can train this model and then show some concepts of using a trained model on it. And even like just to explain what is training as well. Okay, so this is the illustration of linear regression. What you come with is you get a bunch of points. These points are have two sort of coordinates. They have a coordinate on x and y axis. This is the x axis and this is the y axis. And so, for example, this point would have a coordinate 28, 9 something and 5 point something. And so this is one point of the dataset. And so we have a dataset created by a bunch of points, which are somewhere here. And our task in this case is to find kind of, well, somehow model this data. And this is really easy to do on paper because you say, hey, yeah, sure, they are somewhere here and they are moving in this way. And so I imagine that the new points that we appear, that we like see would be appearing here or maybe like here. But how to translate it, how to translate this intuition into mathematical language, that's a whole open question. And so one of these models that we can use is a simple line. And so this red line is basically our model. And if you remember from like the high school education, a line can be described by two parameters, a times x plus b. And so the a parameter influences how steep this slope is, and b parameter is the one that influences how far this goes. So we will see this in the code again, because we will be just plotting some random lines and to see what they create. But right now, this is the description of a model. And so why is it a model? Well, it's some line which kind of, or it's something that corresponds to the data. We can find the one which would be the best possible, which would have the best possible placement for this data. So it means that it would sort of correspond to this data. And we can do this by tweaking those two parameters. So this is a generic, general formula for any line. And changing these a and b, you can get any possible line in the whole space of the 2D world that this is on x and y. In order to kind of mimic whatever this data is, we want to find the line which is lying on it. And now we have to kind of define what it means to be best in terms of having the line in the middle of the data. I mean, intuitively, we can sort of look at it and say, hey, that's the one which is on the data. And when we just put it here, it mimics the direction that this is going on. But we will have to define that somehow mathematically. So what do we mean by the best? By best now is, so this is the best possible placement of the line. And this, in this case, translates to having the line lay on a place where it's the distance from each different point is sort of the smallest. So we are not placing it too far away from none of the points on average. So on average, it's sort of very close to all of the points. I guess that would be the mathematical definition of saying this, right? If we somehow sum all of these distances, we want it in total to be somewhere where these distances are the smallest, right? So I'm saying it one again and again, the same thing. But yeah, basically I'm moving closer and closer to the definition that we are looking for. And so it's quite easy to measure the distance between line and point. And there are more ways how to do it. So one way would be just to look at this distance. Another way would be to look at some like distance in just one dimension. So that's what we will do. We will look at the distance in the y-axis. So, right, the line function is this one. We have seen it before. And what this is, it means that if we put anything here, an x value here, any number x, and we like multiply it and plus the whatever the values we found, we will get a point, the y value, which this point x and y that we got in this way is somewhere on the line. So if we give it 0, we will get this point. If we get 1, it will go over this line up, 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 up. Right. And so that's what it means to have a function for a line. The distance that we will look at in this case is between the line and the point on y-axis. So this is really easy to do. If you have some y point on the line, which is this one, y, and then you have some y point, I mean y coordinate of the points, you can just look at the difference, and then that's your distance. Right. And so this would be enough in theory, but somehow sometimes you get distances which are positive, and sometimes we would get distances which are negative, so below the line. And we can fix that in multiple ways. One would be to have absolute value, so just look at, like, regardless if it's plus or minus, just turn it into plus. Another way is to look at the squared distance. So what that is looking at this distance that we got here and squaring it, meaning multiply whatever this is by itself, so we get this square of distance. And so instead of kind of measuring how far these points are, we are measuring, well, still how far they are, but we are measuring by these squares that they create. Still, if it's somewhere near the line, the box will be small, or the square will be small, and if it's far away from the line, it will be really large, right? So this is a distance between a line and one point. So how can we push that to kind of have all the points in there? So how can we change that in a way that we care about all the points, not just one? Well, to do that, we can just sum these square distances, so all of these squares which we created before, we can just sum them, and then try to find the line which has minimal amount of an error, which is this. So minimal amount of all the summed squares. So again, we will see this again in a code just in a bit, but these distances are the y point minus y line. They are squared, so that's when we are counting together these squares, these red squares, all of them for all points, that's the summation part, and then we just divide it by n, which is something that would not have to be, it's not necessary, it's just dividing it by getting an average of these squares, basically. And so this error or this distance is something that tells us how well the parameters that we chose for the line, how well they fit whatever the data is. So effectively, we will try to change the parameters of the line, the a times x something plus b. So these two parameters, we will be changing them in order to have the best fit. Right. And if you don't get it right now, it doesn't really matter. We can kind of just go into the slides of the, I mean, on the demo, and then we will see it there and we can interact with it. Okay, so with this class, we will be mostly working with demos on the in our Git repo. So this is this one. If you look at it, it's really empty right now because there is no classes updated yet. We, however, have the first week with the first lesson that I'm right now doing, and also this first demo. So this is also what is being referred to here. Notebook week 01 slash or underscore intro motivation, etc., etc. Right. So if you open it, it will show you a the whole notebook here. So all the code that we will be using in this class. We can also run the code immediately, but it will take a little bit of copying around and then using Google Colab. So please copy this link. And this is something that like I will be giving these instructions now and then also in the class, and then again and again, but we will do this often enough that you will learn how to do this. So so let's copy this. Let's go into a address of colab.research.google.com. This one. And for this you will have to have a Google account created. But that's relatively easy to do, even if it's just an empty one for this class. In here, we will go to the GitHub section here, and then we have to copy the, paste the address that we copied from the Git repo. So this is this one. And then don't click this, but just go into search, and it will create a new IPython notebook, which is there just for you, your own copy, which is started from whatever we had here. Okay, so how to operate with this? So these are small blocks of text. I mean, this can be collapsed as well, and this can be collapsed. And these can be run one by one. And you can already see the output here. So this is something I have run before the class and prepared for it, but you can also rerun it. So we will click this run. It will tell me that I'm trying to run something from another author, which is okay, trust me, I'm not hacking into your Google account today. Let's just run it. So I will describe this again in the class. And if you are not in the class, if you're looking at the materials, I will just go through it fast now. So you know what to do, and then you can kind of just follow one by one and read the instructions. But I will add the video from the class probably after this as well, so we will have both. This is a piece of Python code that I just ran. So this code was run somewhere on the Google Cloud machines, and right now I'm just looking at the outputs. So this is a loaded dataset of points. This is something that we had here without the line. And in the course of this example, we will be finding the one line in there. Right. So I will stop because then I will replace it with the recording from the class. But we will arrive at getting a line model out of this. Okay. So what remains until to close this class is to kind of bring in information about the next class, which is we will get more into the nitty-gritty of neural networks. So right now we saw all of these amazing examples of how they can be used and misused and yep, all of this, but we don't really know how to even build one yet or what it is created from. So we will start with the very basics, which is the smallest units, the neurons, which is something that has been inspired by the real human neuron. Well, very much simplified, but still, it's quite an interesting connection there. And then these small building blocks are hooked in some way together into networks. And then these networks are working with some datasets. I mean, we already saw some data today, but we will talk about some canonical datasets next class as well. And then finally, in practicum, we will be programming with some really basic Keras, which is a library used for deep learning. Yeah, so don't worry about this. It will not be super hard as well. I mean, the today's practical example will also be relatively simple. We will go step by step through it together, and so I will be explaining all the steps. This knowledge is something that will be useful later when you are working with the more complicated neural network models. But it's always good to understand the smallest, simplest blocks and then to kind of extract the knowledge from there and then be able to kind of, well, at least have an understanding of what is happening in the more complicated models. Because in the end, it's not that difficult. It is relatively difficult, but not that much. So it's possible to still understand it. Okay, cool. I am sorry to say, but there will be homework for this class. There are two, in fact. One will be a reading assignment, and another will be to fill in your fill in a weekly quiz. So in our Moodle web page, in our Moodle, somewhere at the bottom, right next to the recording and call that will happen tomorrow, because I'm recording this class before, there will be this week quiz, week one quiz. And so what I will be asking you to fill in there is basically your background, so some relatively short and simple information that you can just write about yourself. I would like to know where you are coming from and sort of where your interests in possibly using machine learning lies. And we can sort of figure out where to focus more and where to focus less in reaction to these. So yeah, it's really not that big homework. It's just description of some interests of yours. The other homework is to read a paper, and it's not the first one that we will be reading, but I mean, it's not the last one that we will be reading, but it's the first one, and it's a paper provocatively called CAN, Creative Adversarial Networks, Generating Art by Learning About Styles and Deviating from Style Norms. So this is work by El Gamal from the New York University research team, and from 2017, and it is trying to define what is creativity and what is not when using machine learning models such as GANs, and it's an interesting approach. It's not without its flaws, I think, but it's okay. We can kind of talk about that in the later classes. So I appreciate that you will be learning about something that you don't understand yet about GANs, but you can still learn about the way how these models are talked about, at least. So please read the introduction and methodology, basically the first two parts, and then have a skim through what they arrived at, so the results which they have, and then read the discussion and conclusion as well. I guess what I want from you is to have a think about what they are writing about, and to question if their definitions are actually something that you would accept as an artist. So if what they are telling you is a creative act by this neural network, if it is actually creative as well. And yeah, I mean, there is no clear answer to that, but the link is directly here. Okay, so this is the end for today. It has been probably quite a long class, so thanks for keeping through with it. And I hope that you are still excited about learning about some of these machine learning models and the way how we can use these for creating art. And if not art, well, at least something horrendous as this.